Good morning, church. Great to see you, or be seen by you more accurately. And we trust that this morning will be really encouraging for you. We're looking at a series called To the Ends of the Earth at the moment. And today is a rather sober topic on facing opposition because you are a follower of Jesus. And we'll bring that a little bit later in the service. I've already said this, but a special welcome to those who are visiting online. We're grateful for you to be with us. Jane and the team will be leading us in worship. But as we begin, let's pray together. Our Father, thank you for your great grace to us. We're able to gather together and call you our Father in heaven because of Jesus. Thank you that while we were once far from you, somebody made Jesus known to us. Somebody helped us understand grace, the goodness of God, that we got what we never deserved. And now it tells us, the scriptures say, that once we were enemies, but now we are children of God. We belong to you. We know you. You help us grow to be more like Jesus. And as we come this morning, we come with that reality, that we're not orphans. You've not left us alone, but indeed that you're with us. We would pray that your Spirit might speak, that we might be open, and that you would help us become more like your Son in character and in deed. We pray this through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Thanks, Joan.
Thanks, Jason. Welcome, everyone. Let's start with some singing this morning.
Thank you.
can be reassured this morning that our God is mighty to save. Let's sing together again.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Why don't you say it in your room? Hallelujah. We're grateful to hear from Tanya Lewis and the Lewis family about faith that's like paper. So let's go to our kids' talk right now.
Hi everyone, this is Stripes, and she's one of our chickens. Now Hazel, yesterday what happened?
So it laid her first egg and it was blue.
Was it exciting?
Yes.
Yeah, so here's the egg, and everyone, it's a beautiful blue colour and everyone was really excited about it. You can go play with Stripes. Now, some time ago, Hazel asked for chickens, and we said, oh, we're not really pet people. It's too much work, it's too much effort. Maybe later, maybe sometime, but it's not really our thing. And some people are a little bit like that with faith. They're like, oh, maybe I'll look at it one day, or I can't be bothered, or it's not my thing, or it just seems like too much work. Hazel kept on being interested in chickens, and I said, do some research. How about you read about it? And she did, and she found out more. And I said, well, draw a picture of a chicken. So she drew this beautiful picture of a chicken. We can pin it up, she can pat it. You can remind her of all the fun things about chickens, but it doesn't take any work. It doesn't cost any money. She can go away and leave it. She can forget about it for a few days. And it's no harm. If someone says, do you have a pet? She probably doesn't even have to talk about it. Some people are a bit like that with their faith and love for God too. It's a paper faith, or it's not quite real. It's easy to ignore. It doesn't take any work. But it doesn't really give back, not in the same way that a real chicken does or a real faith does. So eventually we got chickens, and they did take work. Cleaning, feeding, they cost money. Hazel empties the water and cleans out the muck, and Frankie helps her out with cleaning out the chickens. So they take work, but they give back. There's a lot more joy. Hazel has a lot more joy with a real chicken than she could ever have with a piece of paper chicken. And paper chickens don't lay eggs. And this is the sort of love that we need to have for God, a real love, not a paper love, not a paper faith, but a real love that takes work. It might come at a cost. It might be difficult at times, but it's something that we would be ready to talk about, ready to share, ready to celebrate and enjoy. So I think sometimes when we think about our love for God, I want you to think, is it a piece of paper love? Is it a drawing love? Or is it a real live love? Because God has a real alive love for all of us. Let's pray. Dear God, thank you in your Bible that you remind us that a genuine faith is worth more than gold. Thank you that your love for us is real and living. Please keep showing us that love. Fill us and these kids here with joy and hope that only you can give. Amen.
Very good. That was awesome. Tanya did that a few weeks ago, that little talk, and it's interesting. I scheduled it in for today. It fits very well, Tanya, with today's message. I caught up with the mayor during the week, and we recorded our conversation. So we're just going to go to a video now of my catch up with our Unley mayor, which was a little longer than what we're going to see today. Politicians can talk after all, but it was very encouraging to speak with him. So I'll share with this now.
Well, I'm here today. I'm speaking with Mayor Hewitson, and it's really fantastic that he's given us time to be able to talk together. So I thought it'd be great, Mayor, if we could begin with an introduction on yourself and why you mayor.
I grew up in Sheffield Street, Unley, and fairly shortly after moving in, I was asked to run for mayor of Unley, and I said no, but I had our children round for a Sunday lunch, and after about 3 o'clock in the afternoon, I told them the story about how I approached to be mayor, and then I said I wasn't interested, and then I got the lectures I gave my children as headmaster about good people do nothing, bad things happen, civic duty to build a better community. Come on, Dad, you taught all these things, and they're very persuasive. So I put my hat in the ring for the Unley ward, and I thought I was fairly safe putting my hat in. It was good nominations and good people running. And so I thought, well, if I'm running, I better go and meet the people and find out what the issues are. And one of the issues was where somebody had sickness in the family or they had retired on fixed income, they were being squeezed out of money. So that's the first thing. The second thing that concerned me, and it concerns a lot of people, is that UNMI was getting hotter because we're losing our trees. Very slowly at first, 2% of the trees on private land are going every year. And to replace and get back to our 31% cover to be 6 degrees cooler in our blistering summers, and all that is scientifically measurable, and you can see it around UNMI. I mean, just Opie Avenue and Park Street, very close to the church. One street's got 30% tree cover and the other street's got 10. On the same day, 42 degrees in Park Street and Opie Avenue, 32, 10 degrees difference just within one block. And so as a Christian, I think our duty, we are created in the image of God and we have the responsibility to care for this earth that we've been given.
You've mentioned about being a person of faith. How does your kind of civic duty connect to this role or this this faith you have as a Christian?
Okay, let's even get down to the basics. This council term, the most hotly fought issue was whether we have a prayer or not, and whether we are post-Christian, post-belief, and basically 30% of the population would describe secular as not being neutral amongst faith, but the faith of atheism, the belief that there is no God, the belief that all meaning and purpose is in fact a creation of the human mind rather than something that, that truth is relative to individual. And that is a very much growing trend in our society. We are the salt of the earth as Christians. We have the teachings of Jesus Christ to live by. We have a democracy based on the belief that everyone in this democracy has value to contribute. We are equal in the eyes of God. That truth is not obvious. In a biological sense, it's rubbish. Clearly, some of us are much more equal than others in our abilities to be able to do things, in our the physique that we've got, the life length that we've been given, and even by stint of birth, that family support and structure behind us that we have, and the school that our parents actually choose for us to go to. Mm. All of those things have a huge impact, and there's a lot at stake in contributing to the well-being of society as a Christian. Because fundamentally, a secular Australia means it's neutral amongst faiths, not that we're faithless. And indeed, so that was a very hard bit of battle. What we have is a watered down prayer. It is a prayer and it asks for wisdom. It was voted on 6-6. No, it wasn't, 6-5. I didn't have to give a casting vote. One member was away for the vote and he was against it. So the numbers were dead 6-even. I think it's a lost pity. I actually think in a secular society, we should have in our society, a Christian prayer, unashamedly Christian. We should have a prayer like the one we've got, which is Christ neutral, Buddhists, Islam, Muslims, and other faith Sikhs and others could say and join in. And I think we should have a atheistic statement to reflect the range of religions in our society. And as a mayor, I would have, as in a secular governing society, have had used all three. I don't want to impose, but Christ never imposed Christianity on others. That grace, that gift of love, that knowledge of purpose and meaning in a creator, a father of love, is a gift to us and us to share, not to ram down somebody's throat. Yeah. And by our lives we live and our actions and involvement, we show forth the presence of Christ to others. Yeah. That's the way to do it, not through compulsory prayer. And certainly we should stand up for our faith and not allow its removal either.
How do you see churches like ours being contributors into our community?
Look, the church, our church's communities, such as the Only Park Baptist, are the salt of the earth. The job of your church is to preach the gospel of Christ, to share it and show in its life an alternative way of living, a way of caring and meeting the needs of community. No other community I know of shows unconditional love to whoever enters the doors. If Christians don't get involved in society, like if I'd had my way and did the sort of things I'm involved with outside of local government, I mean, I'm on the National Board of Education. I sit on the National Curriculum Committee. I've been teaching since written a book, which is published, which has had quite an effect on the curriculum Every Child Learns. All of that is important, but the contribution one can make in a democratic system is also important. And I would encourage, at the very least, everybody to conscientiously vote and take their responsibilities as a citizen seriously, because we could easily lose it.
Well, thank you, Mayor. I really do appreciate your time. I appreciate your leadership at the council, things like you've spoken about with the advocacy for a truly secular, in the best possible sense.
In government, yes.
Yeah, truly secular, truly pluralist approach to being governing in a way that's fair for all. I think that's really good. I value, you've been very supportive of our local churches here, so I really value all of that. Can I pray for you just as I close?
Certainly can. We do need to do extraordinary things, the confidence of the presence of God in our lives.
Yeah, amen. Let's pray. God, I want to thank you for Mayor Hewitson. I want to thank you for all the council, for all their conviction of doing good for our community. And God, I pray that you'd give them great favour in their efforts, and that indeed that our local area, Unley, would be a great place to live and a just and fair place to live. We think at this time of folk who are vulnerable, socially isolated, the people who, as the Mayor's mentioned, people who might be homeless, and others. And Lord, we would pray that that we see your hand of protection and blessing over our area. And finally, I want to pray, God, that we are a very blessed community, that blessing and that good might be used in a way that's good for all. So help us all be contributors, all be salt and light, we pray, in our society. And I pray this through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Heavenly Father, we just want to lift up to you the people in our church and our wider community who are suffering from illness at the moment. God, we pray that your hand would be upon them and that you would be healing them, that you would bless the doctors looking after them. But most importantly, God, we pray that they would be trusting you in everything and depending on you for what they need. And we just pray for your peace and comfort to be with them. In Jesus' name, amen.
Heavenly Father, you know us in our contentment and in our distress. For those with medical problems, may they seek your wisdom. Grant them accurate diagnoses and helpful treatments. For those grieving because of their separation from loved ones through death, estrangement or isolation, may they seek your comfort and the support of good friends. For those who face trouble because of their belief in you, may they seek your protection and know that your joy is their strength. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's pray. Lord, we praise your name. You are mighty to save. All things are in your control. We think of those in our church family who are facing health challenges, particularly those who have serious health and long-term conditions. Give them the strength they need and the comfort. We think of those who are recovering from injury. Please give them patience as their bodies heal. Be with those who are caring for those loved ones who are unwell. We also think of those who are trapped in cycles of anxiety, depression, and fear. Send them your comfort. We are reminded in Isaiah 41 verse 13, "For I am the Lord your God, who takes hold of you, your right hand. Fear not, for I will help you." We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
I pray for a few folk in our church. And firstly, Lord, I begin by giving you thanks for the birth of little Harriet Emily Waldron. I think I've got that name right, Harry. But Lord Jesus, thank you for Chris and Emily having this beautiful little girl. And we pray that as they learn how to be a mum and a dad, that you might be with them. And that we know, for those of us who've had kids, we know that those first few weeks and months can be quite challenging. So give them an extra portion of strength and grace for that time. Lord, I lift up to you Roger Nardadai, who had a fall this week, and I'd pray, Lord, that you help that shoulder that's particularly no good come good over the next couple of weeks as it starts to knit and heal. And Lord, we'd pray for a great recovery for him. And then Meg Teal, she's a precious lady to us. We don't see enough of her. But only last night, she had some challenges. And Lord, we thank you that she's through it. But she has to deal with some ongoing pain. So be close to her, we ask, Lord. She loves you. She's loved you all her days. And God, in her latter days, we'd pray that she might know your presence, your encouragement to her, and that all those years of forming to be like Jesus might come out from her as she lives life with others. And God, we finally thank you for the generosity of folk in our church. At this time, as there's so much uncertainty, we're grateful that people have given for the work and the ministry of this church in hope that this work that we do might have kingdom impact, might make a difference in people's lives, and especially draw people to you. We would pray that that would be true, that in our labours that we would see your fruit come to bear. Lord, we want to even dare ask that the seed that's planted, especially the seed of your word, might bring fourth fruit 30, 60, 100 times in our people's lives, in our community, and beyond. And this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Jason's going to be speaking to us in a moment about dealing with opposition in our Christian lives. And what I love about this next song is that it reminds us that when God leads us into those tricky, dark, and difficult places, we can be comforted because we know that we will be made strong in Him and be able to cope with those. So let's sing together, Oceans.
The great unknown, where feet may fail. And there I find you in the mystery, in oceans deep, my faith will stand. Above the waves, when oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours, and you are mine. feet may fail and fear surrounds me, you never fail and you won't start now. I will call upon your name, keep my eyes above the waves, where oceans rise, my soul.
Here from April. Now, Bible, from our Bible reading.
Hello, my name's April, and I'll be doing the Bible reading this morning. This morning we have two readings. The first one's from Acts chapter 5, verse 40 to 42, and the second one's from Matthew chapter 5, verse 10 to 16. His speech persuaded them. They called the apostles in and had them flogged. They ordered them not to speak in the name of Jesus and let them go. The apostles left the Sanhedrin, rejoicing because they had been counted worthy of suffering disgrace for the name. Day after day in the temple courts and from house to house, they never stopped teaching and proclaiming the good news that Jesus is the Messiah. And our second reading from Matthew chapter 5, verse 10 to 16. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you. You are the salt of the earth, but if the salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It is no longer good for anything, except to be thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A town built on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. Dear God, thank you for your word. We pray that our hearts are open this morning as Jason speaks to us. Amen.
Good morning again. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness. Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Jesus made sure that this is not in the fine print of following him. It's the ninth beatitude. And he tells us there is a blessing of following him that will be about insult, persecution, and opposition. And he gives two reasons. He says, for the first one, because of righteousness. Because the way that you live will be in contrast to those around you. We've already heard in the Beatitudes, if you remember them, different ways of living, which will be quite different from the society that people are surrounded by. Your way of living will be in conflict sometimes, and definitely in contrast with a society that doesn't share kingdom values. The second thing that he says is you'll be persecuted because of me, because you're a follower of me, that your commitment to me will have a greater claim than any other power or authority around you. And that'll draw opposition. So these things that a follower of Jesus is committed to, a righteous way of living and a commitment to Jesus, means that believers are different and are meant to be seen to be different in the world they're living in. So you will be, Jesus goes on to say, like salt. You'll have an effect on society that is distinctly salty. You'll be like light that shines in contrast to darkness. You'll be like a city that cannot be hidden. It's set on a hill. People will see it. It's built to stand out, and people will be drawn to it. These are the things that you'll be like. And the outcome of living like this is that people will notice you, and hopefully the world is better because of you. And strangely, sometimes people will hate you. Doesn't that seem strange that Christians who try to live well and do good might draw to themselves opposition? But if you think through history and you think through the way that Christians have lived, you'll notice that wherever power is threatened, wherever people's identity is challenged, wherever ways of life is called into question, people bring opposition. And so the disciples of Jesus discovered this reality very early. In Acts chapter 5, as April read for us, already as they're going out and telling the good news that Jesus is Lord to the whole world, already by Acts chapter 5, they've come into conflict. They've not even left Jerusalem yet, and already they are in trouble. What's going on is the church is growing. People are being healed. There are miracles that are happening. People are following Jesus. And the religious authorities in this time are threatened by it. They feel like that the very, I guess, fabric of their faith and certainly their power is under threat because of these followers of Jesus. So they jail the apostles. They put them in jail. And during the night, an angel comes and says, well, actually, we're going to get you out of this jail. And the first thing you need to do is go do the very thing that you were jailed for, which is preaching the good news of Jesus. So they get out of the jail. They go into the temple. And the religious rulers wake up to hear that the apostles have just jailed are already back in the temple by some mysterious hand preaching about Jesus. So they pull them back to the court, and they are angry. In fact, they're angry enough to want their death, the apostles' death. And so they say to them, stop preaching about Jesus, or we will beat you, or worse. And Peter says this very famous memorable line. We must obey God rather than people. They're going to be persecuted because they are followers of Jesus, and there is no greater claim on their life than his lordship. We must obey God rather than people. And the court are in uproar. They want their death. And only because of an intervention by a wise teacher called Gamaliel are they saved. Instead, they're flogged, they're commanded to never speak of Jesus, and they're set free. Of course, they pay no attention to that middle comment and continue to speak of Jesus. All but one of those 12 apostles, including Paul, who was added later, died for preaching about Jesus. And what we see in the apostles, Acts of the Apostles, we see throughout history and we see even into our time, followers of Jesus find themselves in opposition to often society. More people have died, they say, in the 20th century for being a follower of Jesus than all the other centuries, the 1900 other centuries, the 190 other centuries that are counted before. And Open Doors, which you heard briefly from in the little video entry, they serve the persecuted church. It's worth checking out their website to find out more information. But they exist, they say, to help people follow Jesus all over the world, no matter the cost. And what you'll find on their website is what they call the top 50 most dangerous countries to follow Jesus. And you can scroll through places, mostly in Africa and Central Asia, where people are suffering for their faith. For those of us that are going through the Jesus the Game Changer series, Season 2, this week's episode will highlight two countries, Nigeria and Iran. In fact, what's very interesting for us as a church is we also have Iranians in our church who've experienced persecution because of faith in Jesus. And they have a guy called Hassan John. He's from Nigeria and he's leading a church in northern Nigeria. And because of Boko Haram, his church is constantly being burnt to the ground. They've had suicide bombers approach the church gatherings. They've had people beaten. It's just horrific what is normal for them. And it's because they are followers of Jesus. Or then these two sisters, Maryam and Mirzah. I think I've said that wrong. But these two sisters talk about how they became believers and felt like that they'd never seen a Bible before and they'd love to share a Bible with people that they live with. So they arranged for Bibles to be brought into the country. They put Bibles in their backpacks and went off to villages and put those Bibles into letterboxes and various houses. So they end up giving out 20,000 New Testaments to all these various homes. And in the process of that, they got caught, they were jailed, and then they tell this story of all that they go through because they gave out Bibles and they wanted people to know about Jesus. It's just unbelievable what people in these kind of countries endure. And this week, please do watch that episode because you'll get to see and hear just a small portion of what fellow believers go through. As I watched that episode, I felt like these women, just young women, I'd be thinking around 28 maybe 30, these women have strength and have dignity and have courage in their following of Jesus. The pastor, Hassan John, a man of great dignity and strength, seriously challenged. These people kind of have a stature that comes through even on the
video episode. And I wondered about us. What about our stature? If you go through the top 50 countries, the 50 most dangerous countries to be a Christian in, Australia gladly is not on that list. It's not in the top 50. For us, we suffer many things for unknown reasons. We don't necessarily know why we get the hard things that come our way. But when you suffer because you are a follower of Jesus, at least you know why. You know why this pain has come your way. If I said to you, my legs are jelly, I want to throw up, my muscles are burning, my mind is struggling, I'm dehydrated, I can't swallow. If you listen to that, you might say, Jason, you sound really sick. But if I then told you I was running a marathon, you'd say, oh, actually, that pain makes sense. And for anyone who runs a marathon and feels all those things, because the pain makes sense, they push through it. The pain is not the most important thing to them. Their finish line is, and their place in the race. They know why they're in pain. And very often, when we're suffering, one of our greatest struggles is we don't know why. But for a persecuted Christian, they know why. They know exactly why they are suffering. They know why they're in pain. It makes sense to them. Their pain has come to them because they are following Jesus. And that's what I see on the screen as those people shared their stories. Is they know why they're suffering. Doesn't mean that suffering is not brutal, but they know the cause and why. And there Lord Jesus says, blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you. If you are suffering because you are facing opposition as a follower of Jesus, then you can have a sense of joy, a sense of rejoicing and being glad. You are just like the prophets, Jesus said, who were faithful in proclaiming God's word and got a terrible reception. You can be glad because you have a reward in heaven. God himself sees what you are going through and he will be faithful to you. You can be glad because you are salt, because you are light, because the world is better off through your efforts. And you can be glad that people will glorify God through your efforts. This is how persecuted people can make sense of their suffering. If you want to read how 1 Peter chapter 1 speaks to suffering people, he says exactly the same. He says, you have a living hope. You're being brought into a great inheritance. He reminds them of their reward. And he says that God is forming in you a faith that is greater and more precious than gold. He's reminding them of what God is doing in them. This is how Christians who go through great suffering under opposition survive and thrive. You know, Christians throughout the world know this reality, especially those who live in the top 50 most persecuted countries. Open Doors say they exist to support the persecuted church. Their vision is, we believe that caring for the persecuted church should be part of the DNA of every Christian. You know, as I've prepared this week and thought through this, I've realized the persecuted church is not on my mind. It's actually not in my DNA. I'm already prompted to consider how can I do more? In fact, how can we as a church do more? To pray for our persecuted brothers and sisters, to financially support. I do actually want to encourage you, go to the Open Doors website and have a look at what they're doing. Maybe that's one way we could support the persecuted church. I wonder in Australia whether we suffer as Christians. You know, based on the Open Doors data, we're not on the list. I mean, most Western nations are not on a list that says that there's a widespread systematic persecution. And that's a good thing. And I want to suggest to you that is probably because of the Christian shadow in our nation. Open Doors says that the common thread is persecution exists where the gospel is being shared. For that very reason, Open Doors doesn't exist to stop persecution, but to help the local church continue to follow Jesus no matter the cost. You understand that? That where people tell others about Jesus, that's where persecution happens. So doesn't it make you wonder, what is it about us that we don't suffer because of our faith? Many times, if we think just over this year, think about all the points of challenge and suffering in your life. How many times was that because you shared your faith with others? Or because you lived according to kingdom values as a follower of Jesus and there was pushback? If I'm honest, most of my suffering has been because of my stupidity or because of external challenges, health, this pandemic, other crises. Most of those have been around that. Not necessarily because I've shared my faith, or I've lived in with kingdom values in contrast to the society around me. And so these believers that are in persecuted countries know why they suffer. Know that it's because they are followers of Jesus, and that's why it draws them opposition. So it may be hard for us, because we don't suffer in the same way, to understand where their joy and their reward come from, to have their same level of dignity and stature, because they know they've been tested in faith and proven faithful. You know, Paul writes in 2 Timothy 3:12 that everyone who wants to live a godly life will be persecuted. Jesus himself taught, as we've heard, that if you are going to follow me, then you'll know the blessing of opposition. And one of the reasons, I guess, why we don't suffer so much in our society is we do have this Christian shadow. So much of our society has alignment with kingdom values because Christians have brought that into play. But I think we are discovering in a new way that society is not so in step with what Jesus is on about. I mean, the mayor shared a little bit about how there's pressure to not make our society a place where faith can exist alongside each other, but actually to make our society a place where faith has no place at all. This is true of our schools, true of our government, that the people who are normally atheists think that the best option is to have no option around faith. Instead of giving people a wide variety of voice, they say actually faith should have no voice. That's got some sweeping impact if it's not restrained. And that's true not just for Christians, by the way. If we live in a society where Christian faith is marginalized and given no voice, and where Christian young people, and they already feel this, by the way, Christian young people go to school and feel like they're stupid because of their faith, well, if that's true for the Christian, then I want to say it's true for anybody of any faith. It's not good for the majority of people who have faith in Australia, for this atheistic kind of trajectory to not be restrained. And the mayor's right. The mayor's fighting for a value that I think is exactly what Christians would want to fight for, which is that faith should be freely chosen. It shouldn't be a compulsion, but it should also have a voice and a place. Society is giving us more and more reason to live differently. I mean, this since the sexual revolution, especially to now, sexuality is a place that if you are a person who reads the scriptures and says, I want to live according to those scriptures, you'll find yourself living differently. Our sense of where our identity is found and what it means to be human is becoming increasingly different. Our sense of what is tolerance and who has a voice and who doesn't have a voice and how do we speak together in a reasonable way? Well, I've noticed society has changed there. And all these concerns that I've only briefly named are concerns not just for the sake of Christians, actually for the sake of a society as a whole. One of the things that I have been struck by is the notions that Christians hold regarding sexuality are not dissimilar from other peoples. If you're Maori or Aboriginal, if you're a Chinese or Muslim, you have very similar views. And while we Christians might get some heat on having diverse and different views to the society at large, it's important that we have express it and say it, because there are a bunch of people who have no voice who think the same. So to be salt and light is not just to do nice, good things so that people think well of you. Sometimes it's to push against what is not right, what is not in line with the kingdom. And it does bring opposition and it does bring persecution. I know for a fact that our young people who are in public schools, these are high school young people, experience this all the time. That they're in, say, a sex ed class, and the sex ed class teaches a certain way of viewing your bodies and of identity and the choices you make. That if a young person were to speak up at that point, they will get grief, guaranteed. And if the school decides they're going to celebrate certain kinds of choices, then the young person finds themselves in conflict about, what do I do? I value the people, but I don't agree with the choice. These are 13-year-olds, 14-year-olds, who already know that the society they live in is against them when it comes to being a Christian. And so we may feel like our society is more or less in line because of that Christian shadow. But I think the mayor hinted that don't take that for granted. Don't take your voice into our society for granted. And if it brings you heat, then so be it. You know, our church, I think it'd be fair to say our church is a church that is prudent, careful. We have personal faith, and we're private. We find it hard to share that faith with others. So how would we go? Just consider this with me. How would we go if our lives were at stake, or our jobs, or our marriage, or our health, or our respect and place in our community? How would we go if, because we're followers of Jesus, all of those things were threatened? Would you still be prudent, personal, but private? You know, it's actually an easy fallback, isn't it? It's easy in good conditions and in hard times to be prudent, personal, and private. But I want you to understand this. No one in the top 50 nations kind of gets that choice if they really want to follow Jesus. Just meeting together, just reading my Bible to my children in my family is enough to put my life at risk, to put my reputation at stake. They don't get that choice. And so we believers, we're meant to be different. And we're meant to be seen to be different. Our faith is personal and it's public. So what holds us back from taking more risk, from going public with our personal faith? What is in you and me? What are our fears that say to us, be quiet, say nothing, don't speak up? What is it? We're going to hear, as the sermon closes, about a song from Laura Story called The Blessing. And it's a song that covers all challenge. But I want you to pay attention to the words. Because we often consider the challenge, and the song tells us that in the challenge is blessing. In persecution, in opposition, there is blessing. And one of the lines that sticks out for me is the song reminds us this is not our home. We don't live as if this is all there is. Do we? There's a quote from the episode this week, where the guy from Open Door says, I remember, he was speaking to a Chinese believer. He was a 70 or 80-year-old Chinese believer from the underground church. And as our time drew to an end, I said to him, brother, can I pray for you? And he said, yeah, I want you to pray persecution never leaves China. I remember I paused and I said, can you explain that? He said, well, we look at the Australian church as a prophetic example of what happens when faith becomes free. He said, the value of Jesus drops. So I want you to pray persecution never leaves China. This believer, in terrible, trying conditions, can see the blessing in opposition. He can see that there's more to this life, that he has a great reward. He can see the value of Jesus above all things. I wonder, can we? Let me pray. Firstly, we need to pray, our God, for those who are suffering because of their faith across our world. We can scarcely understand what it might mean for them. I think especially of pastoral leaders. When people want to persecute a church, they normally go after the pastor and the pastor's family. And I just pray for those leaders and their families. I pray for their children, their spouses. And I pray that you might give them courage and grace. And I want to even pray, God, that you might bring protection to them, but help them. Help all these folk who are suffering because they live righteously and because they bear witness to you. Lord, for us here in Australia, we don't suffer the same way. And when we fear about the rights and the opposition that we have in our society, we still at the end of the day come back to churches like ours. meet with believers that are on the team together. We're safe in our homes. Our jobs are not at risk. For all this, we're really grateful. But we recognize that there's this effect on us, that our faith, in a sense, becomes weak because it's not tested. I would pray, O God, that you would give us opportunity to share our faith with others, that it won't be just private, it will be public. And we want our God to do this with gentleness and respect in ways that draw people to you. But we also know that at times it will also draw offense. May our love for you be greater than our fear of others. May we still hold to those amazing words that Peter said. We must obey God rather than people. So give us wisdom, give us courage, and help us faithfully follow you. Bear witness to you. Be salt and light in our world, we pray, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
your blessings come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? And what if a thousand sleepless nights are what it takes to know you're near? What if my greatest disappointments or the aching of this life is a revealing of a greater thirst this world can't satisfy? And what if trials of this life, the rain, the storms, the hardest nights, are your mercies in disguise?
Amen. Amen. Don't leave that. Don't leave what God has been saying to you. Please, please take away that kind of call to be more public, to be truly salt and light in our world. I want to close now with our song, Jesus is Our Cornerstone. I'll be out in the front steps, and you can catch me on Facebook, but we want to just finish now with this song as a blessing.
Christ. shall come with trumpet sound. Oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone. For blessed to stand before the throne.
Thanks for joining us this week. And as we go, let's just hear these words. Lord Jesus Christ, send us out with confidence in your word to tell the world of your saving acts and bring glory to your name. Amen. God bless. Have a great week.